I'm going to be talking with you about what the Bible says about heaven, what you always wanted to know about heaven. Probably the most misunderstood doctrine in the scripture, and unfortunately misunderstood by a lot of God's people. We get caught up in the myths that surround heaven. And so we're going to talk about this, and it seems to me very appropriate because the Bible tells us we're going to spend eternity there. And it would make sense, would it not, to check out the place where you're going to live forever and ever and find out all you can about it. And there's a lot in the Bible about it, and we're going to talk about all the different aspects of it. It was Sunday, and in Sunday school, the fifth grade class was convening. The teacher was drilling her class about the gospel and salvation, and she was quizzing them at this particular moment in the class, and she said, "If I sold everything I owned and I gave the money to the church, would that get me into heaven?" And the whole class responded spontaneously with a big nod. "Well," she said, "if I cleaned my house every day, mowed the yard, planted flowers, made my home beautiful, would that get me into heaven?" And once again, everybody said, "No." "Well, if I was kind to animals and polite to my friends, and if I loved my family, would that get me into heaven?" As if programmed, the answer was once again a resounding no. "Well," the teacher said, "then how can I get to heaven?" And a little boy who was new to Sunday school that week shouted out the answer from the back, "You have to be dead." Well, the fact is, that's true, isn't it? If Jesus doesn't return to take us to be with him, the only way you can get to heaven is to die. And that means every one of us has a chance to go to heaven because the current death rate is 100%. And unless Christ returns soon, we're all going to die. Worldwide, 3 people die every second, 180 every minute, nearly 11,000 every hour. And if the Bible is right about what happens to us after death, that means that more than 250,000 people every day go either to heaven or to hell. Here in our country, we seem to have lost interest in all of this. The 2003 Harris poll indicated that 82% of the American people believe in heaven. 63% said they expected to go there after they die. But you can't help but thinking of the old spiritual that says lots of folks talking about heaven and going. If recent trends are any gauge, you may be sitting in a service that's very unusual because you will not hear many sermons preached today about heaven, nor about hell. You will not hear about the nature of paradise that is awaiting all of those who put their trust in Christ. Heaven remains a very popular subject in the imaginations of novelists and filmmakers, but it has become a seldom discussed topic among Christian teachers and preachers of all stripes, Catholic, mainline Protestant, evangelical. Nobody talks about heaven anymore. Among the mainline Protestants, it's thought that speculation about the nature of a personal afterlife is anti-intellectual, belongs to the realm of the sawdust floor evangelist. Some say that too much talk of the next world might distract us from the efforts to relieve suffering in this world. And because the church does not have heaven on its mind, sometimes the church becomes indulgent and self-centered and weak. Sometimes its present comfort consumes its thoughts, and heaven is just an afterthought. And one of the reasons why the statistics from the Barna Research Company and even from the Gallup poll tell us there's just hardly any difference in the stands and morals and living styles between Christians and non-Christians, I believe can be laid at the feet of this great omission in much of the preaching and teaching today. You see, what happens when you forget that God has prepared a place for you in heaven where you will spend eternity, and that it is a glorious, wonderful place, and it's real, and it's not imaginary? When you begin to doubt that, or when you begin to push it off your radar screen, the next thing that happens, because you have a hunger for that in your heart, you start to try to create it here on this earth, and you will spend every dime and go to every extreme to try to figure out how you can make your situation on this earth as much like the things you've heard about heaven as you can. Get rid of the pain, get all the toys, live in a beautiful place, come to Southern California, whatever. And all of it sometimes is the result of not understanding that while those things are okay, you could never approximate that which God has in mind for you in the place we call heaven. You can try for the rest of your life. You can get consultants to help you. You can do anything you can imagine to try to create heaven on earth, and it's impossible. You know, the richest man who ever lived tried it. The wisest man who ever lived tried it. He discovered that it was all just vanity. God has placed within your heart and within mine a hunger for eternity, a hunger for heaven. And if we do not understand that, and if we do not feed that hunger with the spiritual truth of the Word of God, we will end up suppressing that need and replacing it with cheap and tawdry things that will leave us empty and without satisfaction. So what's up with heaven? Today I want to just examine some certain things that I think might be sort of foundational for us as we move forward. I'd like to talk with you for a moment about the prominence of heaven. Did you know mentioned over 500 times in the Bible. In the Old Testament, the word is Shemayim. It's a plural word. It means the heights. In the New Testament, the Greek word is Uranus, and it inspires the name of the planet, Uranus, which is the same name. The word refers to that which is raised up or lofty. So the two words from the Old Testament, Hebrew, from the New Testament, Greek, speak of heaven as a place that is high and lofty and lifted up. And that word is found over and over and over in the Bible. You could not have a Bible if you took the word heaven out. It would just be a mishmash. Heaven is prominent in the teaching of the Scripture. It's prominent in a strange way in our postmodern culture, just not prominent in our hearts, prominent in our thoughts. But I want to talk with you secondly about the plurality of heaven. Did you know the three heavens? You say, man, I'm trying to figure out one. You tell me there's three? When Paul was writing his letter to the Corinthians, his second letter, he mentions an occasion in the 12th chapter when he was caught up, he says, into the third heaven. And then later on, he refers to that as being caught up into paradise. So Paul apparently had a premature opportunity to see the third heaven. Now, if there's such a place as the third heaven, there must be more than one. There has to be at least three. So let me tell you what the three heavens are. First of all, the first heaven is what we might call the atmospheric heaven. The first heaven is mentioned in Scripture a number of times. For instance, in Isaiah 55, verse 9, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down from heaven, the atmospheric heaven refers to that blanket of air immediately surrounding our earth in which birds and clouds move. Genesis 1:20 says it this way, and God said, let the waters abound with an abundance of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the face of the firmament of the heavens. The first heaven is the heaven you see when you walk out into your yard at night and you look up into the sky and you see the envelope sort of that surrounds our earth. But then the second heaven is mentioned in the Bible as well. That is referred to in Genesis chapter 1, verses 14 through 17. Listen to what it says. Then God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night. Let them be for signs and seasons and for days and years, and let them be for the lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light on the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater lights to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. And he made the stars also, and God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light on the earth. The stellar heavens, the second heaven, refers to the outer space that contains the sun, the moon, the stars, and all of the galaxies other than our own. That's the second heaven. But remember, Paul said he was caught up to the third heaven, and this is where we read that in 2 Corinthians 12, 2 through 4. This is what Paul writes. He says, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, he's referring to himself here, who 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know, or whether out of the body I do not know, God knows. Such a one was caught up to a third heaven, and I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, but he was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words which it is not lawful for a man to utter. Paul is saying there is something beyond the atmospheric heaven. There's something beyond the stellar heavens. There is a third heaven, and it is in that heaven that God resides. In fact, in the Bible, we are told over and over again that God is in heaven. We are taught to pray, our Father who art in heaven. In the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 16, we are told that we're to let our light so shine that men might see our good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. Psalm 11:4 says, the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. Whenever you see that referred to as the place where God is, he's not in the atmospheric heaven. He's not in the stellar heavens, in essence of his residence. He is in third heaven, the heaven of heavens, where God resides. And it is that heaven to which we aspire. It is that third heaven where we are going someday to be with God and to be with Jesus Christ. Well, you say, that's good. We have three heavens, and now I know that the third heaven is where I'm going someday if I'm a Christian. So let's talk thirdly, not only about the prominence of heaven and the plurality of it, let's talk about the place of heaven. Turn to John 14, would you please? John chapter 14, and I want to read right at the beginning here the first three verses of John 14. I hope you have a Bible. We got to have Bibles to go to war, don't we? Amen. This is what we study. Amen. If you want to know about heaven, you got to have a Bible. John chapter 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Now let me put this scripture in its context. Jesus had announced to his disciples that he was going to the cross and he was going to die. He was going to be buried and he was going to be resurrected. And then ultimately he was going sometimes looking back on it as history. They were experiencing it as it happened. And Jesus said, I'm going to go away. And his disciples were filled with anxiety, and they wanted to know where and why and how. And Jesus gave them this truth in John 14. He says, I don't want your hearts to be troubled. Don't be filled with anxiety about this. I want to tell you something. In my Father's house, there are many mansions, and I'm going up there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare this place, I'm going to come again and get you and take you where I am, that where I am, you may be also. They didn't understand, but we understand it now, don't we? We know that Jesus was promising something not just to his disciples, but to all of us. And I want you to notice what he says. He went to heaven to prepare a place for us. He did not go to change our state of mind. He did not go to place us in a sort of a spiritual funk so that we would think about good things and that would be our heaven. No, heaven is referred to in the Bible over and over as a place. And there are many metaphors for heaven in the Bible. For instance, on some occasions, heaven is referred to as a country. And when we hear that, we're reminded of the vastness of its territory. Sometimes it's referred to as the celestial city. When we think of heaven as a city, we see in our mind's eye the inhabitants and the marketplace and the commerce. Sometimes heaven is referred to as a kingdom. And when we refer to it as a kingdom, we think of the organization and the government and the process. But the best definition of heaven, in my estimation, is right here in John chapter 14, where Jesus said, it's my Father's house. Most of us who grew up in warm and loving families have great memories of the Father's house. Something about it, it's like a magnet that draws you back. Whether you move across the country or even around the world, there's something about the Father's house that you want to come back to. My wife and I used to drive on a weekend over 1,000 miles one way to come back to the Father's house just to spend 2 or 3 hours there and then turn around and go back. You see, there's something very intimate and sweet and personal about heaven when you talk about it being the Father's house. It's no longer an empty space. In your mind's eye, you see furniture. You see decorations on. You see the warmth that's a part of a home. And Jesus has promised us that if we put our trust in him, he has prepared a place for us in heaven that is in his Father's house. And we are privileged to be a part of living there in that place forever and ever. Please hear me. Heaven is not, as some people say, an imaginary place. Some people say heaven is a benevolent state of mind, a reward for being good. Some say heaven or hell is whatever you make of it in this life, a projection of the best in yourself. But listen to me, men and women. Heaven is not a figment of imagination. It is not a feeling or emotion. Heaven is not the beautiful isle of somewhere. Heaven is not merely a thought form. It is not a projection of the best in you. It is not a vision of a longed-for utopia. It is not a pleasing hope or the invention of man. Our thoughts do not make heaven. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. In that same chapter where Jesus said, in my house are many mansions, he tells us how to make the reservation. And I want to tell you something. It's the greatest good news I could ever say. Almighty God is still accepting reservations for you. Amen. If you've never put your trust in Christ, it's not too late. Not too late yet. Amen. Remember, I read to you from John chapter 14, and I said that when Jesus got done telling everybody where he was going, that Thomas, the doubter, Thomas said, Lord, we don't even know where you're going. How can we get there? We don't have a map. We don't know anything. We don't know how to get there. But Jesus spoke to all of the disciples in verse 6, and he said, Thomas, I know you don't know where I'm going, and I know you don't know how to get there, but let me just put your heart at ease. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through. There is only one way to heaven. That's through Jesus Christ. It's not about a religion. It's not about a church. It's not about a dogma. It's about a person. Jesus is the way. If you have never put your trust in him, your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if you should die today, seek entrance to heaven, you would be denied. Not because you are good, bad, or indifferent, but for one simple reason. Jesus is the only way to heaven. Those are not my words. It's not Baptist doctrine. That's the word of God. God says, Jesus is the only way. If you want to go to the Father's house, the only way you can get there is through Jesus. I want to ask you this morning this question. Have you put your trust in him alone for eternal life? I'm asking you if you're a good person. I'm not asking you if you go to church. I'm asking you one question. Has there ever been a time in your life when, knowing what you were doing, you asked Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Savior, to forgive your sin and give you eternal life? Has there ever been a time like that? And if there has, you know it in your heart. And if there hasn't, you're very uncomfortable right now.
tired of being lost. It's time I control. As my crew floats like astronauts, I watch as we get old. We'll meet again some other day. I hope you'll finally see that the hardest thing I've ever done is say goodbye to me. And I dream that you're not left alone.
Gotta say God bless you.